evening and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the June 14th, 2016 meeting of the Downers Grove Village Council. It is my distinct privilege to call this meeting to order. There are copies of our agenda on either side of the room. If you haven't already done so, feel free to pick up a copy and you can follow along with our proceedings tonight. There will be multiple opportunities for public comment, both with respect to items that are on our agenda tonight, as well as a segment under item 4, which is dedicated for public comments and questions of a general nature with respect to things that are not on tonight's agenda. It is our proud custom to begin our meetings by reciting the Pledge of Allegiance, so at this point I would like to ask everyone to please rise and join us in reciting the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's good to say the pledge on Flag Day.
Yes, it would be a crime if we skipped it. And with that, I'd like to ask our fine village clerk, April Holden, to please call the roll.
Commissioner Waldeck.
Here.
Commissioner White.
Here.
Commissioner Vitimo.
Here.
Commissioner Jose.
Here.
Commissioner Olson.
Here.
Commissioner Barnett.
Here.
Mayor Tully.
Here. Thank you very much. That brings us to item 3, which pertains to minutes of prior council meetings. We have one set of minutes to approve tonight. And those are our council meetings, council minute meetings from our June 7th, 2016 meeting. Are there any questions, comments, corrections, or changes?
Mayor Tully, I move to approve the June 7th, 2016 minutes as presented.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Those minutes are approved. Thank you. Just like that, we're at item 4, public comments of a general nature. This is the opportunity for any members of the audience to raise any questions or make any comments of a general nature with respect to things that are not on tonight's agenda. If anyone would like to make a comment or a question at this point in time of a general nature, the protocol is please come down to the podium, tell us who you are, and we welcome hearing from you. Any questions or comments of a general nature? Hearing none, because everybody wants to get to the exciting stuff. We're going to move on to item 5, our consent agenda. Do we have a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented?
Mayor Tully, I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
Are there any questions or comments from anyone in the audience on any of the consent agenda items? Any questions or comments from members of the Village Council? Hearing none, may I have a roll call, please.
Commissioner Olson.
Aye.
Commissioner White.
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck.
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo.
Aye.
Commissioner Jose.
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett.
Aye.
Mayor Tully.
Aye. Consent agenda passes unanimously. That brings us to item 6, our active agenda. We have a number of items on our active agenda tonight. And very exciting active agenda items. First, I have a motion to adopt a resolution granting historic preservation. Let me back up a minute. As they say in Hollywood, take two. Do I have a motion to adopt a resolution granting historic landmark designation for 701 Maple Avenue?
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt a resolution granting historic landmark designation for 701 Maple Avenue as presented.
I second the motion to grant landmark designation for 701 Maple Avenue.
Thank you. Are there any questions or comments from any members of the audience with respect to this item? Questions or comments from members of the Village Council?
Very pleased to see this moving forward.
I'm sorry, didn't hear you.
I'm very pleased to see this moving forward.
Thank you. I'll say that I'm very pleased to see all three of the landmark designations moving forward, and I'll repeat that after each one. As those who have been following our activities of recent days, the Village made a concerted effort to try to not only simplify the process for historic landmark designation, but also to promote it better and to engage with the community in recognition, celebration, and acknowledgement of the rich historic tradition that we have in our community. And I couldn't be smiling more than a mule chewing briars with how many we have coming forward to us today. Three all on one agenda. This brings the grand total to way more than we had in many, many years of experience. So that's the good part, but this isn't about us. The real heroes of the day are those who are bringing forward their properties for landmark designation. And we greatly appreciate folks taking advantage of it. We're glad to see that it's achieving its intended purpose. And I'll have one more comment for the third one when we get there. May I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Olson.
Aye.
Commissioner White.
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck.
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo.
Aye.
Commissioner Jose.
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett.
Aye.
Mayor Tully.
Aye. And with that, the Village Council unanimously has granted historic landmark preservation status to 701 Maple Avenue, the Herring House. And as is Consistent with our tradition, I would like to ask the owners, Beau and Christine Martin, to please come up, and I can present you with your hot-off-the-press certificate. Please, all families welcome.
Congratulations.
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 Well, we will call you. You guys need to hold this.
Thank you.
Congratulations. I've asked the Martins to share a few words about the house with those who might be interested who are here tonight.
We don't have to say who we are tonight. I would just like to say, as you mentioned also, Mayor Tully, that the procedure for landmarking is easy, it's quick, and enjoyable. And so we're proud to do it, not for us, but we're proud of the house. And we're proud to be owners of the house and that we've had the experience to put it back together and so it can be done. And so that's why we want to landmark it kind of for the house itself. So.
And we thank the city staff as well.
For helping. Yeah, that's been helpful too.
So. Thank you very much. So appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
Very good. That brings us to item 6B on our agenda. Do I have a motion to adopt a resolution granting historic landmark designation for 5226 Carpenter Street in the Village of Downers Grove?
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt the resolution granting historic landmark designation for 5226 Carpenter Street as presented.
I second the motion to grant landmark status for 5226.
There's a motion and a second. Are there any questions or comments from any members of the audience with respect to this item? Questions or comments from the members of the Village Council? I'll reiterate what I said with respect to the last one. My thanks to Charlotte and Byron Holson for coming forward and landmarking their home. I'm glad to once again to see that the changes that have been made in the education, awareness, and celebration are having the intended effect. But again, without folks volunteering to do this, it wouldn't happen. So we're deeply grateful to you for doing it. And I'll call you up in a moment. But for now, may I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The Village Council has unanimously granted historic landmark status to the Foster House at 5226 Carpenter Street, and I'd like to ask Charlotte and Byron Holson to please come up as the owners of the home. I have an equally hot-off-the-press certificate for you.
Everybody that's helped make this possible, because we looked at the way it was before and we thought, no, not going to do that. So when it got changed, we thought, what an awesome opportunity. And we had already, our house was already under the Centennial Homes. And when I first did the research 26 years ago, you didn't have the internet and you didn't have all the people that are helping now. And so I originally thought it was built by John Oldfield and Hannah Oldfield, and they were big contributors to the community, but they didn't build the original part, which is the back part, which is what Alexander and Nancy Foster built, and it was built in 1868, and they're buried in the Main Street Cemetery.
Terrific. So, thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome.
And again, congratulations.
Thanks.
That brings us to item 6C as in Charlie. Do I have a motion to adopt a resolution granting historic landmark designation status for 1000 Burlington Avenue in the Village of Downers Grove?
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt a resolution granting historic landmark designation for 1000 Burlington Avenue as presented.
Second.
Are any questions or comments from the audience on this item? Questions or comments from the village council? On this one, I just want to add that sometimes it's important to lead by example, although we seem to have not been fast enough. A few of you got in before us, but the village takes very seriously its commitment to historic preservation, so we thought, why, what better to do than to look around and see what public buildings we have that could qualify for landmark designation status? And by the address, you might not know what it is, but 1000 Burlington Avenue is the Main Street train station, which is a public building, which has a rich history. There's a plaque there if you've ever had the occasion to read some of the events that took place. And in a moment, I'm going to give them a heads up. I am going to ask Dan Popovich to maybe share a little bit of information about the property, so I'll give him time to pull himself together. But this is very important because, obviously, the private property owner's residential is a terrific a path forward in this regard. We want to lead by example, so I'm very pleased to see the village doing this with respect to this property, and there may be others. For the trifecta, we have to continue to work on a commercial property with historic value, achieving this landmark status. And with that, I will ask for a roll call.
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That matter passed unanimously, and the Main Street train station has now been granted historic landmark designation status. Congratulations to the whole community. And we thought it might be a bit presumptive to present a certificate to ourselves, but what I will do is ask our community planning director, Stan Popovich, to please come up and maybe just share a few words about the location.
Sure, Mayor. Thank you so much, and thanks for the heads up. I usually don't come prepared to talk when there's items on the active agenda for me. So the train station, as you know, is the main and Burlington Avenue there. It's got a classical revival architecture with a little bit of Beaux Arts in there. As you mentioned, there's a lot of history with the Zephyr train crash there, the community outreach to help the accident victims, and then also to rebuild that train station there at that site. I think the interesting facts about this are that the train station was desired to be a pedestrian-friendly new passenger station because of the livestock that was in Downers Grove prior to 1911. So I thought that was pretty interesting. There's some history that Friends of the Edwards House put together that talked about the ladies in the dresses and the mud and the stuff in the street. So I thought that was really great. As you know, it's the third busiest metro station outside of Union Station. It's a great gateway into Chicago for the passengers through here. And we're just very excited to, as you mentioned, leading by example here and designating the train station as a historic landmark.
Terrific. Thank you very much for sharing that, and thank you for your work on the project.
You're welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. That brings us to item 6D as in David. Do I have a motion to adopt a resolution approving the preliminary plat of subdivision for 5527 through 5531 Fairmont Avenue with exceptions?
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt a resolution approving the preliminary plat of subdivision with exceptions for 5527 to 5531 Fairmont Avenue as presented.
Second.
Commissioner?
Thank you. I just wanted to state I think we do need an opportunity for council to discuss this a bit further before we vote on it. So I think the reason I put forward this motion at this time is to open, procedurally to open the discussion so we could have a discussion and perhaps take further action once the discussion has taken place, either vote or perhaps table another time.
Thank you for that clarification. As is the procedure, I'll ask for comments from the audience, but then we'll have a discussion and comments from the village council when we get to that point, and we'll see where we go. Any questions or comments from members of the audience at this point? Very good. Questions or comments from members of the village council? Oh, I'm sorry. Good evening, welcome.
Good evening, Mayor Tully, commissioners, staff. Brief comment, no PowerPoints. I just wanted to reiterate the principles of the concerns that I had. And the first one was the distance of the homes being only 14 feet apart. I don't think that is suitable for that neighborhood. So I believe that needs more work to be properly addressed. And then also the stormwater issues. You know, we have people complaining just today about stormwater. You know, backing up in their backyards. So I think it's important to make sure that we're taking the appropriate action. I do believe that the reason for the 75-foot lot was to start to mitigate that issue, and there was a lot of deliberation around that. I do have to say some things that I like about it. I like the fact that this builder lives in the neighborhood, and he's lived there for 15 years. He's willing to invest in that neighborhood and move a few houses down the street. I'm certainly not opposed to the other petitioner moving into a nicer home, but those were my concerns, and hopefully the commission, the council, will be able to address those concerns adequately.
Thank you for your comments. Appreciate you sharing them. Please.
Do I need to be sworn in?
No, this isn't the Plan Commission. We'll just tell us who you are, and we'll be glad to hear from you.
Good evening. I'm Joe Galvin. I'm a resident of Downers Grove, been a resident since 1971. I actually live in the neighborhood, live right across the street. Known the Bowies and the Helms for a long time. Great people. And I think it's going to be a great project for the neighborhood. It's, to me, it makes common sense. I've seen a lot of changes in town, a lot of changes. I like that neighborhood. I like that block. But with the three houses that are currently on the property, it's an eyesore. And it's there are some safety concerns as well. There are stormwater issues because they haven't been addressed in the past. And Mr. Bowie is going to take care of those issues. He's been a builder in town for years, done a lot of nice projects. I just think it's overall, it's going to be a great benefit to the community, not only aesthetically, but it's going to add value to our block, to our town, and it's also going to increase the taxable revenue, not only for the village, but for the county. So you have to look at the bringing in three new properties on three parcels and that tax benefit as well. So I just want to let you know that I'm supportive of it, as well as my family is as well. So they can't make it here tonight, but I just want to let you know. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for coming down and sharing that with us. We appreciate it. Other questions or comments in the audience? Good evening, welcome.
Good evening, I'm Dan Bowie, 5541 Fairmount, petitioner, and I just wanted to say thank you for the time to discuss this one last time. Some key points I wanted to make is that the density will not increase because there's already three dwellings on the two properties. I think that's important to realize. The other thing is it's the lots on that street are varied already. I mean, they range from 55 feet to well over 100 and everything in between. Two lots just to the south are 58 feet, so it's not really out of character with the neighborhood. So we've had a lot of neighborhood support, just like Mr. Galvin. We had actually we have overwhelming support in the neighborhood, so hopefully you'll take that all into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate your comments. Any questions or comments from the audience before we start council discussion? All right, very good. Thanks for those. Questions or comments from members of the village council? Commissioner White.
What struck me reading the Plan Commission minutes and the presentations made at the last time this was before us is the fact that the majority of the neighbors do support this project. And there's no question that density and protecting the community from stormwater concerns is what we should be most concerned about. However, the people most directly affected believe that it's not too dense, and they believe that it may improve their stormwater. That's something that I think this council should very much take into account. Therefore, what I'm suggesting is that I'm inclined to support the three lots with certain specific conditions. One is that whether we approve three lots of just under 72 feet or two lots of 75 feet and one lot of 65 feet, that the side yard setbacks be 7.5 feet so that they have the same side yard setbacks as if it were a 75-foot lot. That way the houses will be no closer to each other than they would have been if there was a full 225 feet to work with. Second, I'd want the subdivision plan subject to the village engineer being satisfied that the site plan, the grading and the work on the site will materially improve the stormwater drainage situation. And third, since part of the property lies within the floodplain that exits Barth Pond, I'd like to be consideration of granting a stormwater management easement over a certain portion of the rear lot. And I'm not an expert, I can't say how far that should be. That's something that I think should be discussed between the owners and the village staff. And I think before we vote on this, it would be prudent to have some of the terms of that subdivision agreement put in writing and published so that prior to a future meeting, those terms can be specified. So basically, I'm in favor of the concept. I want to make sure there's enough width between the houses. I want to make sure that we have something in writing that helps advance stormwater management. But with those conditions, I'm in favor of granting, of allowing those, all three lots to be built upon. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Olson?
Thank you. I support Commissioner White, the conditions that Commissioner White just said and just stated. I also, you know, Commissioner White didn't state directly whether he wanted it to be three equal size lots or 275 and 165. Foot lot. And I don't know where the consensus of this council is, but from my perspective, I think either would work. You know, if there's no clear opinion, if there's no clear opinion of the council for any specific reason, my default would be to default to the request of the petitioner. But I really am ambivalent on that point. But I do support the conditions that Commissioner White has outlined.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Waldeck.
Thank you, Mayor. One of the concerns I had was a trend in the neighborhood, and while I agree with Commissioner White's suggestions, I think I would prefer to see 275s and the 65 basically added to that. In that way, the trend would be towards the enforcing the codes that we currently have rather than making an exception.
That's a good point, and I hadn't thought of it, and I support that point.
Thank you. And I thank Commissioner White for his suggestions. Also, before we vote on this, I would like to commend the Plan Commission for their work. It was 6-2 against. And, you know, this isn't a message that we're overruling or opposing the Plan Commission, because I think they did an excellent job in reviewing this. I think the conclusion that they came up with was correct in the sense that they were enforcing the rules, which is what we asked them to do. The options after the Plan Commission makes their decision, the options come to us, and then we have the latitude to make these types of changes and to take other things into consideration. But the Plan Commission, I think, was excellent in enforcing the rules, and I hope they continue to do so. And the times when they don't enforce the rules is when council, I believe, is when council asks them to research a question and ask their opinion on various issues. But when deciding land use, I think enforcement is important. I think they should be commended for it. Thank you.
Thanks, Commissioner. Commissioner Jose.
Thank you, Mayor. Excuse me. I, too, support the conditions that Commissioner White's already discussed. I won't repeat them. I think it's great that these ideas are coming forward. I know I talked offline with a couple of folks about them as well. So I like the idea of the lot split. It means a lot in my analysis that the neighborhood is largely in favor. I actually would take the opposite view of Commissioner Waldeck with regard to how they're split up. I take your point, but my view of it would be that with smaller exceptions the 71 and a half or so foot lots, we're sure there are three of them to be sure, but I'd rather have the smaller exception than the larger exception of going from 75 down to 65. I think that's a stronger precedent in my mind. So I'd rather have the larger lots for all three as opposed to just two. But at the end of the day, I'm willing to live with the balance of the council. Thanks, Mayor.
Thank you. Other questions or comments from Commissioner Bettina?
I'll just say that I also agree with Commissioner White's conditions. And, you know, I think it's going to be great for the neighborhood, and the fact that the neighbors support it is wonderful, and the fact that the builder lives in town and cares about what's going on is good to see.
Commissioner Barnett?
I
don't have to, obviously.
No, I'm fine. Go fine.
Okay, fair enough. Kate, unfortunately, I wasn't able to weigh in on this last week due to professional commitments, but I have heard a lot of different conversation about it and different ideas on how to achieve what is really the objective of a number of different things that I think our code is trying to accomplish, but it's difficult to do in the certain framework that we're dealing with. And I again, will concur with Commissioner Waldeck that this isn't in any way, shape, or form a disagreement with the Plan Commission because they're simply doing what they were asked to do. But sometimes, as the policy-making body of this village, we have to figure out ways to achieve objectives in creative ways. And I've heard a number of different things before tonight and including during this discussion. They're not all necessarily the same, but they're all consistent in the outcome. What I would propose is maybe what we do, because also it's probably fair to the petitioner, is maybe we table this for a short period of time, try to work out some of these details. I'm hearing general consensus, but maybe the details are slightly different. But more importantly, I would not want to vote on something without having an opportunity to work out those details with the petitioner to see what actually would be acceptable or not. And I don't know if anyone would be interested in tabling this for a short period of time to try to see if we can achieve the objectives that in many respects are exactly what we're trying to accomplish in a different way.
Mayor Tully, I would be supportive of that, but the one thing I would just ask if we get direction on for staff's benefit is the issue of the 75, 75, 65 or the 371 and two-thirds foot lots. I've heard Commissioner Waldeck and myself say we'd be in favor of 75, 75, 65. I've heard Commissioner Jose said he's in support of three equally sized lots, and I think it'd be helpful to staff if we could give direction on that before we table this.
Would that be helpful to staff if we give direction?
That would be greatly appreciated. Right. Thank you.
I have no problem with the consensus of the council. If that's what Commissioner White is proposing, it's fine with me.
Okay. Well, I didn't specifically address that when I first spoke. My preference is two 75s and a 65. If the consensus of council is to do almost 72s, I'll still vote in favor of it. So it's not something that's going to change my vote one way or the other. My preference would be two 75s and a 65. To Commissioner Jose's point, yes, the one variation is larger, but there's fewer variations, and then two out of three lots will be conforming. So there's like six to one if it doesn't have the other. There's pros and cons on both sides.
Right, and there are other land use planning tools that I've heard proposed that, frankly, I've not had sufficient time to adequately consider, which is the other reason, selfishly, I'm interested in tabling this.
And actually, it's something I do want to add about the benefit or value of working out the details of the agreement is that then those details can be part of what's published the Friday before the meeting, not just respect to the petitioner, but with respect to the public in general. Because I'm not sure many people, other than those who are kind of on the inside of this, know what the discussion has been. This way, all of the conditions we put in writing and put out on the website the Friday before the vote, I think that improves public transparency, not just for the people involved, but for the entire community. So I am also in favor of basically having this come back to us once we have the specific terms worked out. And there's also the issue of working out, if in fact it can be worked out about granting the village a stormwater management easement, how much? Because I don't know. I think there should be something, but I don't know how much.
In short, I think we can get there a different way, is what we're saying. Commissioner Barnett.
I'm certainly fine with tabling this. Commissioner Waldeck's and White's comments really are mirror very much the comments I circulated last week. I'd encourage us all to remember that our staff is pretty good at what they do. Whether 75, 75, 65, or some other thing, whether there's an easement of X number of feet in the back. The 75 feet in much of our ordinance is designed to try and foster likely outcomes. But those outcomes are what's really important. And I think that staff and the audience and certainly the petitioner all know that those outcomes of stormwater management, character of the neighborhood, space between building consistencies are things that we all value and our priorities to us. I'm fine with tabling it. I would suggest that I would be fine with most of the variations and of possibility there, I'd like our staff to work that out with the petitioner. I mean, they're not going to come back to us with 5-foot setbacks on 155-foot lot. They're just not. So I'm inclined to table it. Certainly that's fine by me, but I'd like to give less, frankly, specific direction. I think it's a perfectly valid point that we would see those in their form before we decide on it. That makes tons of sense. And Mayor, I don't know if you were alluding to different vehicles, but there certainly may be other vehicles by which to accomplish this, which frankly is for our crack legal team to chime in on. So I'm fine with this discussion and all the aspects of it, and I certainly would support the idea of tabling it.
In that case,
make a motion.
Is there a motion to table?
I'll make a motion to table the item to date certain being June 21st.
Second. Is the motion a second? Does that give you enough time?
Yes.
Thank you. Any discussion on the motion to table? Or we can't have a discussion.
I don't think it's debated.
Correct.
There being no discussion on the motion to table, may I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitiemo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The matter has been tabled to June 22nd. And staff has sufficient direction to figure out how to achieve the objectives that would address what sounds like the neighborhood and everyone else is looking for. Very good. That brings us to item 6E as in Edward. Do I have a motion to adopt an ordinance granting a stormwater variance for 1740 63rd Street?
Mayor Tully, I move to adopt an ordinance granting a stormwater variance for 1740 63rd Street as presented.
Second.
Questions or comments from members of the audience with respect to this item? Questions or comments from members of the Village Council? Commissioner Waldeck?
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate staff coming up with a clearer font and wording than we discussed last week. This is a unique attempt to resolve a problem. The garage was under the line, and storage of dangerous materials could have been in the flood area. And hopefully this will resolve it. I know we're a little short on the enforcement of this, you know, no real answers on that, but there will be fines if they are caught to be in violation, I believe. And so I will support this. This is unique, and it also tells future purchasers of the property that there certainly is a problem, which they wouldn't have otherwise. So I will support this. Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions or comments from members of the council? Hearing none, roll call, please.
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitiemo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. The matter passes unanimously. That brings us to the end of our active agenda and to the beginning of our first reading or our workshop agenda, where items are presented for discussion purposes only. No action is taken at this time. We have one item on our first reading or workshop agenda tonight. That is item 7A. As is customary, I typically ask village staff via the village manager to present the item for consideration. Mr. Fieldman, good evening.
Good evening, Mayor. Good evening, Mayor Tully. Excuse me. Thank you. Just one item on the agenda tonight, and that is an ordinance amending traffic provisions at the intersection of Lacey and Esplanade Roads. And here to present information on this item is our Public Works Director, Nan Newland.
Good evening, Nan.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Thank you, Dave. An ordinance has been prepared to amend a section of the municipal code concerning a designated all-way stop control at the intersection of Lacey Road and Esplanade Road, showed here on this exhibit. This item was brought forward at the request of Hamilton Partners, who's the developer of the Esplanade. This development is located south of Butterfield Road and west of I-355. There's two main points of access onto Butterfield Road. We have a signalized intersection at Wood Creek Drive, and then there is this secondary access here off of Esplanade Drive, which is primarily a right turn lane for people that want to go southbound. So they're going east on Butterfield for a short distance, getting on the ramp and going south, which is the predominant traffic movement. There's a couple of concerns that they have with access, both with regard to getting people out efficiently as well as safety about this intersection. What happens in the evening is there's a considerable amount of traffic that's trying to do the same movement, so it backs up onto Butterfield, backs up onto an Esplanade, and Lacey Road currently goes through. There's no stop here at Esplanade. So for people trying to get out of the parking garages, they are trying to find gaps in the distance here between cars on Lacey, and they are backing up as well, trying to get out. So Hamilton and Partners approached the village about looking at all other alternatives for this intersection. They did have their consultant, SE3, perform an analysis of warrant study, which is included in the packet. It was within a couple of vehicles of meeting the warrants for this intersection. We thought it was close enough to really warrant taking a good look at this intersection. So what we did, we had some concerns about the kind of the disparity of the geometry. You can see that Lacey Road is quite a bit wider. We have four lanes with left turn lanes versus Esplanade, which is about three lanes wide. This comes into play with a four-way stop with visibility and just drivers' perception of who stops for who. So one thing we proposed to Hamilton Partners was that the intersection be narrowed by taking out those left turn lanes, which get very little traffic, put in the stop sign, and adding those in red dots you can see in the middle of the intersections, additional stop signs. And we asked them to do this for a month-long period under a temporary control, which is some temporary barrels and barricades and signage. And we said we would monitor it, which we have been doing for about the last 6 to 8 weeks. About 2 weeks ago, we went out with our consultant. We reviewed the data and viewed the operation and found everything to be working. There were no crashes reported, and everyone seems to feel it's a better solution than what was happening previously. The two things that Hamilton Partners is committed to, they are working with IDOT up at Butterfield to convert that one lane out and one lane in to two lanes out. And they have received approval for those changes from IDOT and will be moving forward with those changes, which is one thing that will help alleviate that backup coming out from Esplanade. The other thing they've committed to is performing the changes to the intersection, if this is approved, to make these safety enhancements to the intersection and help it operate better. So with your concurrence, staff would recommend making this change to convert this intersection to a four-way stop, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you have.
Thank you. The workshop, we reverse it, start with the Village Council first so that we can get some more information before entertaining public comment, since this is the first time it's being presented to us. Are there questions or comments from the Village Council at this juncture, particularly of Nan? Commissioner Olson?
Well, I don't have any specific questions at this time, but I do have some thoughts on this item. I don't support the item. I view this issue as this solution as a 24-hour solution to a 30-minute problem. This is a permanent solution, a stop sign that is in operation 24 hours a day. There's an issue that's been raised with regard to evening traffic in a short period of time when folks are leaving the building, which I respect and understand. But I also note that we have certain situations in the village that are similar. For example, on 31st Street, there are a number of high-rise office buildings there, and there are some intersections there where you have essentially a smaller street intersecting, a smaller street similar to Esplanade, intersecting with a larger street, 31st Street, in this case, Lacey Road. What's done there is you have off-duty police officers or sheriff's deputies to assist with the traffic movement during that specific peak time at the cost of the property owner. I think that's a far more reasonable solution here than, or perhaps other solutions as well could be considered, but from my perspective, a 24-hour solution to a 30-minute problem is really somewhat unwarranted, especially given the nature of these streets. I mean, Lacey Road is four-lane divided with, you know, grass medians in the center. I don't view this as reasonable, so I generally don't support it, and I wanted to get those thoughts out there to my colleagues.
Thank you, Commissioner. Other questions or comments from the council? Commissioner Waldeck?
I'm not sure if I agree with Commissioner Olson. I think he raises an excellent point. I wonder if there is a better solution. He used the word unwarranted, and Nan used the word warranted, but only by a little bit. And that was with the traffic study that was paid for by the petitioner.
I would note that the warrant study didn't, it was off by a little bit. So it wasn't just a little bit over, it was just a little bit under.
So given the circumstances, I think Commissioner Olson raises a point about private having the owner use private staff to manage that traffic intersection. Or another one might be, since IDOT is planning some changes, maybe the petitioner could get a traffic light. They could operate mostly, you know, and stop traffic during the peak hours and allow traffic to move freely during the regular hours. I don't know what the costs are. I don't know if they'd be interested in that. I know IDOT would be involved. Just questions. This is a workshop, fortunately, and those are just questions I have and concerns. How much for, you know, would they be interested in a private staffing and the possibility of working out a traffic signal during the peak hours? Thank you.
Thank you. Other questions or comments from members of the council? I appreciate the comments that have been made and clearly like to hear more. That's why it's a workshop. I know that this is a good example of where the village has tried to work with private property owners and business in particular. And this is one of those examples where we proclaim ourselves to be business friendly and want to facilitate rather than regulate. It was a request to assist one of our commercial residents in a way that they thought would be helpful to them. So I certainly appreciate the efforts to try to accommodate that. I know that's something that all my colleagues support. Whether this is ultimately the best solution, that remains to be seen. I know this area very well. I'm not suggesting that others don't, but I'm not sure how much traffic is there that's going to be inconvenienced in later hours anyway. And it can be a challenging intersection, so I'm certainly open to this remedy, particularly since it was at the request of the private property owner. And I understand that other situations and other roads, we don't have control over all those roads. Sometimes it's other roads that have to be dealt with through either the county or the state. To the extent that we have an ability to try to assist one of our commercial residents, I certainly want to be accommodating when we can, if it makes sense. And I'm not deciding where I would stand on this one way or the other right now, other than I would like to be of assistance if we can. But I hear the comments that have been raised, and I will continue to think about them. Commissioner Barnett?
I just, is the objection, David, is it the sort of the principle behind us taking care of a problem generated by a private land user, or is it the technical merits of this as a solution?
I think it's really the combination of both that brings it together for me. I feel like, from my perspective, I look at this as an issue that rises to the level of something that could be addressed in a more targeted manner by the landowner, or perhaps in a larger thing if they're to work with IDOT and such to, you know, proposals to do something much larger. But I also believe that we're not in a situation where the studies, even, you know, the studies that are done by the professionals also are marginal at best in terms of proving this is actually needed. I mean, if it was shown that, you know, if that was overwhelming, I think this would, I think I would be less objectionable to it. If one was overwhelming to another. But in this case, it's kind of marginal real need from the data perspective, and given the other situation with, you know, the private landowner, I'm a little bit leery of this in general.
The other thing that occurs to me, sorry, I didn't get a chance to mention earlier, is I do know from the last 15 years that the village has tried to be responsive from an economic development, attraction, and retention standpoint particularly for the Class A office space that we have. And we do try to, within reason, accommodate it because it's consistent with our overall objectives of attracting and retaining high-quality corporate headquarters and other businesses in our community that have other benefits to all our residents. And the other reason why I'm very wanting to try to find out the proper way to address this, and I'm not suggesting that I'm not open to some adjustments here, is that one of the things that we always say, whether it's a residential project or it's a commercial project, whenever faced with traffic concerns, is that we will adjust accordingly and take measures to try to address those issues as we see them develop in the field. And so part of me is this an example of where as situations change and traffic situations or traffic experiences require some kind of intervention, is this one of those examples? Because I know there are many other situations where folks express concerns about traffic and safety, and our typical response is we understand and we will take what measures we need to when the time presents itself to ameliorate those if all possible. And I'm not necessarily saying this is one of those situations, but that's kind of where my head is right now. Other questions or comments from the council before I open it up for any questions or comments from the audience? Commissioner Jose.
Thank you, Mayor. Just one quick one. Have there been a number of accidents at this particular intersection, or have we tracked that at all?
We did check, and there have been no crashes at this intersection.
Thanks, Mayor.
Sure. With that, obviously we're not taking any action on this tonight. That's why it's a workshop. But any questions or comments from members of the audience on this item? Okay, well, more to come. Thank you.
That ends our first reading tonight, Mayor.
Thank you. That brings us to item 8, the Mayor's Report. I just have two things I want to note. First, congratulations to the Downers Grove South girls softball team. They took third in the state softball championship. It was real close. Too bad they had a shot at first or second place. They came back in the third place match and won, so congratulations to them. And I don't know what other state champs that we may have had this year, but as long as we have that wonderful thing called the Independence Day Parade coming up, I thought it might be appropriate to invite them to participate in that parade. It's always nice to have more than less in our parade, and if the coaches and the players were interested, that might be a nice gesture.
We'll do.
And second, I have to say that there are only 9 days left until the Downers Grove Grove Fest, which will be happening, of course, in the last week of June here in the streets of downtown, the lovely streets of downtown Downers Grove. You've no doubt seen signs and posters all over town. I know we'll see lots of our friends and neighbors there. It is the world's largest and greatest block party. We're all looking forward to that. And I'm sorry because I've been away for professional reasons, but are we planning on having a council presence again this year?
Yes.
Excellent. So I can then safely say that one of the other things you'll be able to do during Grove Fest is come down and visit with members of the Village Council from time to time. We'll have a presence at the event, and we look forward to that as well. That ends my report and brings us to our Village Attorney's report. Ms. Petrarca.
Thank you, Mayor. Only one item to present this evening, and it is an ordinance amending traffic provisions at the intersection of Lacey and Esplanade Road. This will be on next week's active agenda. Thank you. That is all.
Thank you. And before I get to council member reports, I just want to give everyone a heads up that when we get to item 12, the manager's report, that will be given next door in the committee room. So what we will do is we will
recess
to the committee room for discussion of the long-range plan update. And obviously everyone here is welcome to join us across the hall for that discussion, but we will conclude our business in this room. With that said, we'll go back to item 10, which is reserved for council member reports. This is an opportunity for members of the Village Council to report out on significant goings-on in the community or anything in their role as liaisons to any other public bodies or boards and commissions. I'll start to my right with Commissioner Jose.
No report, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Commissioner Walbeck.
No report.
Thank you. Commissioner Vitimo.
No.
Commissioner Barnett?
No report, Mayor.
Commissioner White?
No report.
Commissioner Olson?
No report.
Very efficient. That brings us to item 11, which is reserved for council member new business items. We have one item of new business tonight. As is customary, the council member who raised the item of new business is given an opportunity to introduce it, and then we'll have whatever discussion we have and go from there. Commissioner Waldeck was the one who raised this new business item, so Commissioner Waldeck, you have the floor to introduce it to the rest of up here.
Thank you, Mayor. If can let me, whether I should make a preliminary statement or just move to the motion. I'd like to move that we direct staff to draft a resolution amending Exhibit B of the council policy on ethical standards. And the reason why you offer it is...
I'll second the motion.
Oh, sorry.
All right, we have a motion to second, so I'll ask for comments. Commissioner Waldeck.
Thank you, Mayor, again. This is a request to work with staff to review and suggest modifications to the council finance policy. The current policy is less transparent. It has what I believe to be some serious legal issues. This was before the new Supreme Court decisions, and I think that it should be reviewed. It hasn't been reviewed in a number of years, and I believe it should be reviewed in light of the recent decisions.
Thank you for the introduction, Commissioner. Any other questions or comments from members of the council? Commissioner White.
A brief comment. First of all, I'd like to see it renamed campaign finance, because it's actually, that's actually far, in my opinion, far more descriptive of what we're really talking about here. Also, I agree that there are two specific topics areas that have changed since this ordinance was drafted, most specifically the Citizens United decision. And second, there have been changes to the state campaign finance laws. And as a consequence, the language of this ordinance may not fit nicely with the state law. So the idea of talking about it, and I won't go into the specific merits of various elements of Exhibit B. I have opinions on that, but I don't think it's time to do that. But I do think that because of Citizens United and changes in the state campaign finance laws that have occurred since the ordinance was first drafted, it gives us an opportunity to discuss it.
Thank you, Commissioner Wilson.
I'm going to support this item. I agree that I think it is always important to review our policies, our ordinances, et cetera, to ensure that they are in compliance with state and federal law. And in this case, I think we're dealing with laws as high as the United States Constitution as interpreted by the United States Supreme Court. And I think that our policies and ordinances should need to be in compliance. And so I support Commissioner Waldeck's motion to direct staff to prepare a resolution amending this to make sure that bring it into compliance with all those higher bodies.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? Commissioner Barnett.
It's hard to argue with motherhood and apple pie, so I can't certainly argue with the idea of review and making sure we're in compliance and that we fit with other higher authorities. I am a little disappointed that same interest in periodic review isn't extended to other areas like zoning, which affect our neighbors and our residents and our businesses on a day-in and day-out basis. It's been the better part of 5 years now that call has been made, and it hasn't risen up the priority level. And that's fine. We have priorities we don't get to. But it's a little disappointing to think this one might get up above something like that. But the idea of reviewing it is entirely appropriate. I totally support that.
Thank you. Other questions or comments? Commissioner Cole?
No.
So from my perspective, I certainly agree with the call to review the policy, perhaps rename the policy. We should review and update all our policies as appropriate. However, and believe me, I've been on record as having my issues with this policy as written. But I do agree that I do question the priority of this, and here's why. And by the way, I don't want the headline tomorrow to read "Ethics Not a Priority for Mayor Tully," because that's not what I'm saying here. This is really about campaign finance, and that's important because this policy really applies to the seven of us. It's really who it applies to, and that's a really small minority. And there are other things that apply to the entire community. And my view is not that we shouldn't get to this, but that we should deal with bigger circle items first, and the small things, and this is about as small a circle as you can get, I just don't think takes precedent over other important things. And frankly, what I would suggest is, since we're going to go next door and talk about our long-range plan update and the very topic of priorities of the very competing interests that we and staff deal with all the time. My preference would be that we table this for a short time to go have our conversation about all the different things that are on the table and see where this fits, because I personally would appreciate the opportunity to see how this fits into the broader scheme, and I think the community and all of us would benefit from that. So to summarize, I have no objection. In fact, I share Commissioner Waldeck's call to make some much-needed changes to including renaming this policy. But I just can't put this at the top of the list when there are things, what Commissioner Barnett mentioned is only one of them, that I think are things that affect the entire community we should address first. Commissioner Jose?
Thank you, Mayor. Now I'll jump in. I share your concerns about prioritization. I also welcome the opportunity to review this particular policy. I think it is necessary and appropriate. That said, I think, you know, staff is pretty good at telling us when they're maxed out on bandwidth, and hopefully this isn't something that would take a lot of time. As if it is, I trust that they will prioritize it accordingly, but I don't see any reason not to move forward with it at the moment. Thanks.
Thank you. Commissioner Waldeck.
I've been kind of tiptoeing around the legality of it all. First off, I don't think it's going to take a lot of staff time. If it did, I would agree with you. Also, I think we are open to possibilities that we don't want. Like you say, I'm tiptoeing here. So I don't think that there would be any problem finding some simplified language to fix this by next week. It's not going to take a lot of bandwidth. If it does, you know, we can always, next week when we look at it and we get into our usual several meeting debates or whatever, we could table it at that time if it does begin to take up too much bandwidth. But I don't see the bandwidth. I think there's not going to be that much time taken to resolve some of the problems that this policy has.
Fair enough. And while I've made my views clear, I'm not going to vote against proceeding if that's the consensus of the council, because I do think we need to do it. I haven't heard anybody say we don't need to do it. It's just a simply of what do we get to when. If I'm hearing what you're suggesting, Commissioner, is that if we were to learn next week, this is going to be a far more involved project than perhaps we initially think, that you would be open to deprioritizing, that's a bad word, but perhaps what did we used to be called? Right-sizing an organization used to be the term.
I prefer deprioritizing.
Totally deprioritizes ethics. That's what I heard.
Has somebody tweeted that already? We can reevaluate its position in the line.
That's basically what I mean.
Because if everyone's open, if everyone's open to that,
that's where I'm at. It takes a lot of time. I don't want to do it.
All right. Well, that's what I wanted to hear. I think it was important for staff.
We're fast to get it done. Yeah.
Any other questions or comments on the motion that's been seconded?
I just want to say I support it. If it can be done by next week, why not? If it's simple language, let's do it.
Okay. Last chance. Have a roll call, please.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. That matter passes unanimously, and hopefully we've provided sufficient direction to staff to know what needs to be done.
We'll wander in the woods.
We don't know. We don't want wandering in the woods.
All right, Mayor Tully, I move to recess to move to the committee room.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Olson?
Aye.
Commissioner White?
Aye.
Commissioner Waldeck?
Aye.
Commissioner Vitimo?
Aye.
Commissioner Jose?
Aye.
Commissioner Barnett?
Aye.
Mayor Tully?
Aye. Thank you. We are recessed to the committee room. We'll probably resume in about 10 minutes for those who want to stay. It will be televised, so those watching at home, stay tuned. Thank you. Good night.
Let's watch television.
Joining us, our guests. We are in the committee room for the manager's report. So fortunately, the manager is before us. Give his report with respect to the long-range plan update. Mr. Fieldman.
Thank you, Mayor Tully. We are here for a long-range plan update. You may recall that this council put together a long-range plan affecting 2015 to 2017 and beyond. We did that last summer. As is our tradition, we revisit and update the plan the summer following that, just to refresh it and really to look at identifying and discussing issues that will affect us in the coming years in a material manner, and items which may show up as part of our fiscal year budgeting discussion. So items, in this case, that may be presented and become an issue in the proposed FY17 budget. Earlier tonight, you heard the mayor talk about updating our priorities for the long-range plan, our work plan, if you will. You may recall that back in the middle of May, that discussion took place, and we did make some updates to our priorities as far as our work plan, and you can find those updates on our website. Tonight, we've identified two issues for discussion that may affect us, particularly in the next year's budget and beyond. One is issues related to pressures on the property tax levy. The second are issues related to the cost of public safety pensions and other post-employment benefits, known as OPEB. So what I'd first like to do is just outline some of the issues that we now see forming related to the property tax levy. Three things that may cause the tax levy to increase in 2017 and or 2018. The first is required contributions to our public safety pensions, the pensions that support our retired police and firefighters. Bottom line on the tax impact for these required contributions is somewhere between $800,000 and $1.3 million worth of increase that could take place over the next 2 years. We do know for sure that in 2017, our annual contribution will increase by about $500,000. That is required under state law, and that's based on the actuarial reports. We further learned in speaking with the actuaries that prepare those reports that we can expect a $300,000 a year increase in our required contributions as the plan is working and all the assumptions in that plan are followed. So the annual increase is expected to be about $300,000. There is one other potential for an increase in the required contributions in this area, and that is if the fire pension board and or the police pension boards vote to change their assumption in their actuarial model on the rate of return of their investments. If they vote to reduce that rate of return in the model by 0.25%, then if they both do it, that could be another $500,000 increase in our required contribution. So those are the three reasons that public safety pension contributions as required by law could increase between $800,000 and $1.3 million in the next 2 years.
Dave, could you remind us about the police and fire pension boards?
Yes.
What they are and, you know, why they, I mean, can we control them, et cetera?
Right. Police and fire pension boards consist of five individuals. They are the stewards of the public safety pensions, the police pension fund, the fire pension fund. They are autonomous, and they are the fiduciaries for those funds. So we do not have any direct control. I'm happy to say that we work very well with our police and fire pension board members and have enjoyed a strong and effective working relationship. But they are autonomous.
Thank you.
The second issue is really a shift in tax dollars that will show up as an increase on the village side, but there is a corresponding decrease in the library tax levy. And that is the levy for our planned police station improvements of about $600,000 a year. This is the tax revenue that would support the issuance of the bonds that would pay for the improvements to the police station. That levy would start probably in 2018, and by that time there would be a fully offset elimination of the levy that has been on the books for the library, paying off the improvements to the library that were made in the mid-1990s. So that levy was about $620,000. That levy would go away and would be replaced by the levy for the police station improvements. So it would show up as an increase when you look only at the village, but on the broader perspective of your entire tax bill, it would be offset, a wash. The third issue that could affect our tax levy in the future is the whatever decision this council makes on stormwater utility and how we generate revenue for that, those sets of activities, including operations and maintenance and capital. You may recall from our stormwater utility discussions that the council has authorized and directed us to have $3.9 million worth of revenue dedicated to needed stormwater maintenance and improvements for next year. The question is, will this remain entirely on a fee-based system, or will it shift all the way over to putting that $3.9 million in the property taxes, or anywhere in between? And that's a decision that this council will make in November or December of this year. So we just wanted to put together all of these three things that are affecting the future property tax levy, and we have summarized them here on the board, showing how the levy could move, both in a best case and worst case scenario, on these three line items. And I won't repeat what's here on the table. You can just focus your attention on the impact to a typical house. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions, and really interested in hearing any council community discussion on this item.
Thank you, Dave. Plainly, there's an awful lot of stuff on the left side of that board, and I think it's starting to tilt. And I'm concerned about trying to manage it, or obviously there's things on the right side of the board we haven't talked about. But how we manage the situation, because unfortunately, we're dealing with two different buckets. We're dealing with things that we have control over, and then there's things we don't have control over. Unless there's public safety employee pension reform of some sort, we're not going to be able to do a whole lot about that first bullet point. We can do things about the second one, but that's pretty much something we've worked through pretty extensively. And I've heard every single one of us say that it is something we must do, which is go forward with the police station improvements. No one's backing out of that now. The thing that concerns me, if we're going to add more onto that through something that is also within our control and not, with all due respect, not something I consider to be urgent. I understand that there's strong views of addressing that, but there's no magic that it has to be done this year as opposed to another year. When we're facing some of these other potential thumbs on the scale of the property tax for the homeowners, I would be very reluctant to take that step now and add another thumb on that scale when we don't have to. Unless there are suggestions from things on the right side or elsewhere as to how to offset it or otherwise adjust it. I do realize also that some of that might be driven by answers we get to some questions that we're talking about putting out there. But that may be another reason not to have an impact that would overlap with the maybe the same time frame as the first two bullet points. But that's the one thing I have a concern about. And I'll stop talking and allow others to weigh in. Phil?
I'm going to work backwards. With the stormwater, either we're taking money from the residents out of their right pocket or their left pocket, and we've decided that we're going to put the question to them. So if it would become a tax increase, it's really upon their vote what they would prefer to see. It's not a good choice. You know, it's going to cost them either way, but at least that part of it's their choice.
Except, not to interrupt, but the rest of that, those other two bullet points, aren't going to be on a referendum question.
Well, I'm working back. Okay, the second issue with the Village Hall, yes, we agreed to move ahead with that, and that's one of the options that we've taken. And then we get to the first one, which the average person, when they turn on the TV and they hear about all the fun that's going on at Springfield and things getting tossed back and forth, and people hear the word pensions, they kind of throw up their hands because they don't fully understand it. But they know it's a problem, and they don't know what Springfield has been doing for the last number of years. They've been borrowing from the pension fund, they've been underfunding, they've been doing all kinds of things with the pension fund, and now they're in a mess. And I think I commend staff for presenting this six-page presentation, and they explain the pension, which if everybody would, every resident would look at it, would not only understand our challenges with the pension, but they'd also understand a little better what's going on in Springfield and why it's such a mess there. I look at the first section. It says the levy for the public safety pensions. It says will increase by $500,000 in 2017, approximately $300,000 thereafter, to make the required contributions pursuant to state law. It's not our fault. it's state law. This is a rock and a hard place. This is the rock that Springfield is thrown. The second part is may increase up to $500,000 for the next year if the police pension board changes and the fire pension board changes their assumed rate of return. What we've had as a history is they would project a certain rate of return. If they did well, in other words, if their version of the stock market or other investments, and they're not, you know, this isn't totally stock market related, it's bonds and all kinds of complicated things, but when they've done well, we've lowered taxes appropriately. When they've done poorly, we have to raise taxes because we have to pay the bill. The bill has to be paid. So the idea that they're going to lower the rate of return, I mean, to 7.2%, I think a lot of people are out there looking for 7.2% or 7.5. You know, they could make us all happy and assume a 9%. We could budget a 9% increase. And if we don't make it, then we got to hit them with the taxes anyway. So this is kind of like truth in returning. If they happen to make their numbers, they do spectacular, then we don't have to raise the contribution or raise it less because we have to do this long range. We owe the money. So the second one is the hard place. The first one is the rock. So that's all I got. Oh, and one more thing. I think this is so well done. If we could get staff, if we could get Doug up, you know, I complimented the write-up on the lead situation with the water. I think this would be a good 15-minute presentation as well to forewarn the public of what's coming down tax-wise. Thanks.
I'd like to do more than warn. I'd like to do something to mitigate.
I kind of agree with Mr. Waldeck there that we really can't do much about the public safety pension, and you know the stormwater is something that we are still deciding on, and the police station, you know, I'm not ready to give that up.
You can't do it unless it's a kind of
no. So no. I feel like, you know, that it kind of needs to be done.
The only way that I see to reduce the number is to reduce our commitment to funding stormwater, and I'm not prepared to do that.
Yeah, I'm not
because I will fight to the death that a dollar in stormwater utility, a dollar in property taxes, is a dollar out of our citizens' pocket, and they're equal. So that's why we need to ask the community which they wish to pay. That's why I run the referendum.
Could I just comment on that? I think this last, you know, clearly this is, you look at these numbers and it's just like, I mean, you know, I feel like as a taxpayer, I just look at it and almost like roll my eyes, like, oh my God, you know, more of the same, right? The tax is going up and this is, it's disheartening. So, you know, that's the initial reaction. And then I look back at, you know, these bullet points. And I think there's a little bit of a story that I think does need to be filled. You do have that third bullet point, as Commissioner Waldeck said. You know, this is really part of the reason we're considering referendum questions is to ask the public. I mean, he is right. Whether it's out of the property tax or whether it's the stormwater utility, people are paying it. So that the if you're looking at the net cost to the taxpayer, you know, the net cost is really, you know, not changing significantly. Now, you know, granted, there's some change, this and that. Right, and I would personally pay less, but, you know, some would pay more, various comments and things of that we could get into. But ultimately, I view that as we're gonna allow, given the important public nature of this question, and the fact that people have had experience with under both systems, as the mayor has pointed out numerous times, we're gonna throw this question to the public and really get some feedback before we make any decisions. And so I think that's really important, and I think we're allowing that appropriate public input because this is, you know, an important question, and you know, clearly the mayor and I may view it differently on the merits of the question, but I think
no doubt about it, this is a question that's worthwhile for people to think about. When we get to the public safety pensions, I mean, I think when I look at this, it again points out every time these numbers come out and these numbers are discussed, the need for public safety pension reform becomes clearer to me. Unfortunately, the seven of us here don't have the authority or the ability to make those decisions, and in a gridlocked Springfield that we seem to have, I'm not hopeful that anyone is going to see any sort of benefit or large ability to make any significant changes to public safety pensions. I'm not anticipating it, and we do need to fund as required. I mean, that's
we're all complaining about the numbers up there, but I'd like to hear more about the strategies, but things that we can possibly do. And I wasn't suggesting we're not going to ask the referendum questions. I'm just suggesting that I think we might want to think about the timing of when things get impacted and making changes. Because I would disagree about the way the way that it's distributed. It's a fact that under a property tax system, there's a disproportionate burden paid by the single-family residences, as opposed to under a stormwater utility fee. And to have that increase exacerbated by any kind of shift, I think it's gonna hit typical household more than necessary. I'm saying if you're gonna do that, fine, but if you're gonna do it the same year when some of these other things come down the pipeline, I think you're gonna get more than people rolling their eyes, that's my point. I think you're gonna be rolling something else.
And I think we can, once we have the referendum questions, we can continue to, we can continue to discuss that and have those results. And perhaps the result is that people want to see it exactly the same as it is, and there'll be no change and no decisions had to be made on timing of it. But if people are overwhelmingly saying that we should return to the property tax levy, then I think that's also an important piece.
Timing
will be a question. Just one final comment before I conclude my remarks on this point. The police station improvements, what we've said all along, what I've said all along in this, is that I've wanted to find a solution that we're able to make necessary improvements without making major impact to the taxpayer. And the reason that we've set the budget, the reason that the budget was established in the first place, was in order to capitalize on the fact of this timing. In fact, this bond issuance is rolling off, and we're able to make this needed improvement without a material impact on the overall picture. So, I think that it's certainly challenging to get into the line items and argue about the line items and what line is what. But we've talked about this all along, and it's a way that I established the budget, and I've been continually encouraging staff to challenge the budget and challenge the assumptions to bring that down and to bring that number into perhaps that number can come down slightly as we go through some of the design phases, but and would further encourage staff on that point. But it is something that we need to do to ensure that we're able to provide the first class public safety services that the community does expect.
Bob?
I think we're kind of tap dancing around stuff here, guys. Timing, next year's not gonna be great timing. Does anybody believe, based on stormwater expectations and public safety pensions, that 2 years from now is gonna be better timing? Anybody? Wanna put that out there?
Not me.
we're kind of acting like we only have these three things. Consider, we spend a lot of money on a lot of things, and I remember a couple of years ago we had a budget meeting over at Fire Station 2 where I was whining then, like I often do, about sustainability. Martin, I think you were in on that conversation as well. We don't have sustainability unless we mean by sustainability a million or so every year increase in property taxes. And so I think that what this is telling us is that we really need to have
really serious conversations about service levels. We sit here and say we want to fund stormwater because you can't hardly live in Downers Grove and say, I don't want to fund stormwater, right? Because it's flooding everywhere. But it is $3.9 million a year. You can't really sit here and say we want to provide top quality public services and then say you don't really want to have Fire Station 1 open anymore. But you know what? It's part of what we choose to spend money on every year. And if we're going to get $800 to $1.3 million of public safety pensions over the next 3 years, likely between $300 and $500 a year for the foreseeable future, and we know we've got existing things to maintain, but those costs go up as well, I think we got to start having conversations that go way beyond the three things on the board where we look and say, oh, public safety pensions, we can't do anything about it. Well, obviously. But we can do something about another $40 million worth of spending decisions. Not all of it, obviously. But a lot of it we could adjust. And I don't think we're doing all we can do. We're working as hard as we say we're working, unless we're really getting into those kinds of conversations. I'm ready to have it if anybody else will join me. But it's not. This is not going to get all of a sudden a lot better or a lot less pressure. It's just going to continue to grow at this kind of a rate.
Okay. Commissioner?
Thank you, Mayor. I don't want to be too repetitive. I'm always willing to engage in a conversation, whether it's on service levels or any other topic. So if the rest of the council is, let's have it. And I look forward to the budget discussion in October, November. As has been said, the police station has to get done. I think I'm on record saying it's not a perfect plan, but it does what we needed to do for the moment. And I think that's very important because that the police station has been deplorable for longer than I care to mention. With regard to the public safety pensions, yes, it's all controlled by Springfield. But I think, you know, we need to remember, and I think it's worth saying, and I know it's, I see it up here under the key facts, although we haven't gotten to it yet, that we always do make the contributions as a village that are required to be made into the fund. We don't miss a payment. Some other folks do. Downers Grove does not. I think that's important to say. And I think it's important also to remember that our employees are putting into these funds their own money as well, out of their checks, and that they take an awful lot of risks on our behalf and sometimes pay the price for that. So yes, public safety funding, public safety pensions is an issue. Yes, the issue, it has to be solved in Springfield, but thanks to all those who are earning those pensions.
See, I want to follow up on that. Public safety pensions, these are actuarial contributions towards future liability. It's like putting money into your mortgage escrow account. So basically, pay now or pay later, but it's going to be, it's basically going to our basic liabilities.
Well, if you get a good, if you get a good investment return, it's also cheaper to pay now.
Yeah, well, so that's why, that's my thing. And
so what if we said, you know, that, I mean, without rehashing the police station discussion, that $600,000 is $600,000 of cost to the taxpayers that could otherwise be going away. The pension contributions, we're going to make those. I mean, I don't hear anybody suggesting ever in the time that I've been sitting up here that we're going to somehow try and avoid making those. But you're looking at somewhere between $500,000 and $1 million a year of costs that are kind of not beyond our control, but they're things that are getting foisted upon us. What if we said that between now and then, when we get serious about the budget, we were looking for some input from our village staff team on how to find another $1 million of service level cuts that we could make to offset it? We wouldn't have to make them, obviously. But if we don't sort of get into that, you know, we just kind of kick the general concept around, and then all of a sudden it's budget time. We're not going to be prepared to have those kinds. That's a way longer conversation than 4 or 5 budget meetings between, you know, October and November.
Well, to really get into that conversation, I don't think we want to go back to the days of find $500,000 in the budget you can turn out, find $1 million, some arbitrary number. You really have to start talking about is what are fundamental services that we deliver that if they were eliminated, they would achieve those kinds of savings. Not go find me a few nickels here and a few nickels there that add up to some number. That doesn't really get you anywhere. You're literally talking, because first of all, that's only on a 1-year basis.
Well, Oh, sure.
To really do that, you're talking about not doing something or doing something differently or having somebody else do it. That on a long-term basis would fundamentally change one of the costs in this village.
Absolutely.
Of that magnitude.
You're right, absolutely.
That's what the real question is.
Totally agree.
And yep. If there are suggestions as to what those are, I would encourage everybody to speak up and put them on the table. Because historically, there's been a lot of gnashing of teeth and wringing of hands. But when it comes to it, I rarely hear actually the suggestions.
Well, there's actually a very good reason for that, which is that nobody wants to pay taxes and nobody wants their services cut.
Yeah. It's also called have your cake and eat it too.
Exactly. And then, you know, so as a consequence, you know, proposing significant service cuts would be very politically unpopular.
Well,
and raising taxes is politically unpopular.
Not necessarily a cut.
Well, eliminating.
That's why we're here.
Or outsourcing.
Well, if it's really cheaper, or if it's just sort of falling cheaper.
Well, I would be remiss if I didn't take this opportunity to segue right into the other issue because
yes,
we're talking
strategies.
About it. Right now, the second issue we've identified has to do again with public safety pensions and other post-employment benefits, which is really the provision of required health benefits to retired employees. Let's start over here where the council was just talking about public safety pensions. The issue is simple, it's already been stated. The unfunded liability for the village continues to go up, and the percent funded measure, one of many measures of health of the pension funds, have tended to be flat or gone down, even as we as a village have contributed more and more money to these funds. So unfunded liability is going up, percent funded is flat or declining, and that issue may affect our bond rating going forward. Some key facts I think have already been stated. The benefits and the rules of the pension funds are set by the state. The village makes all the required contributions and has for as long as any staff member here can remember or was able to look up. We have always made our required contributions. In 2012, the state made some changes to contribution requirements. Since that time, 2013 and beyond, the village has contributed slightly more than the minimum required each year. And that is because the minimum target for percent funded at the state level is you're aiming for a 90% funded level at the end of the day. Well, it didn't make sense for our pension boards or our council to aim for 90%. We are on track for 100% funding. So we make a little bit more than the minimum contribution each year with 100% target as our goal. I've already said that the percent funded has declined. Okay, so what can we do about this issue? There's two very simple things to write on a board, and they can be very difficult decisions, as Commissioner White just stated. One is we could simply put more money into it. As a strategy, make more than the contributions we're already making in an effort to reduce the amount of unfunded liability. That really just puts more pressure over here. The other issue is what Commissioner Barnett and others were just talking about, and that is, should we be considering changes to staffing levels and service levels related to our very valued public safety employees? That's exactly what the council was talking about here. Why is this the strategy? Because every other aspect of this issue is really beyond our control. It's either controlled by the state or it's controlled by the general labor market. We're not really going to pay, nor should we pay, our public safety employees less in the market. That's not how we roll. We wouldn't suggest that in the first place. And we certainly wouldn't suggest not following the state rules. So what's left? How many people we have? What types of services they're providing? So that's the issue related to public safety pensions and how it may affect our bond rating moving forward. This is a different issue, but it's going to sound exactly like the public safety pension issue. This is the OPEB, other post-employment benefits. I'm going to start here with the key facts because a lot of us may be not familiar with this concept. All municipalities in the state are required to provide health benefits to retired employees. That's a requirement of the state that we do that, and we're happy to do so. That means we have retired employees on our health insurance plan. OPEB, other post-employment benefits, that liability is the difference between the village's cost of providing those benefits, the claims experience, if you will, and how much those retirees are contributing in aggregate to the fund. If you think about retirees as a group, even though they're paying 100% of the required premiums into our plan, the cost of the services, the claims, the benefits we pay out on their behalf almost always exceed the contributions we get in. And so what's going on here is we have to go through an actuarial calculation to determine what the village's liability is. What is our liability now for that future cost, the difference between the cost of providing the service and what these employees, our retired employees, are paying us. Why is this an issue now? Because the Government Accounting Standards Board, or GASB as Judy refers to them, has a pronouncement that says you have to calculate this on an actuarial basis, just like pensions. We have to do that now, and it shows up in our financial reports. And in 2 years, those liabilities will actually flow through our financial, our audit. And so the liabilities would become very measurable and very real and will affect our bottom line. A side note, there's another driver of cost that really has become noticed in the last couple of years, and that is what we refer to as PSEBA, Public Safety Employee Benefit Act. This is a state law that requires us to provide health insurance for our team members at public safety that have become disabled and unable to work, have suffered a catastrophic injury while working in that capacity. The provision of those post-employment benefits, the liability on the village side has increased by $3 million in the last 2 years. And it looks like that will continue to go up. So our issue here sounds very similar to what we've just been talking about. Our unfunded liability, which has now been calculated at $11 million and growing, will appear in our future financial reports, our audits, and also may affect our bond rating moving forward. What are the strategies here? Well, the first thing is we could consider treating OPEB exactly like we treat pensions. Set up a fund, a trust fund, where the village contributes money to try to set aside money now for the future liability costs. Treat it just like a pension fund. The other concept is this. Consider changing employee and village contributions to cover the cost of OPEB now. So all of our employees pay premiums for their health benefits. The concept here is not only will the village make a contribution to this fund while the employees are still working here, but the employees, part of their premium would be labeled and segregated as a contribution within this fund for OPEB. So if I pay a premium, X dollars of it would go towards the benefits while I'm working, and another portion of it would be labeled and distributed into the OPEB fund. Any way you look at this, this is village and employee dollars going into a fund now.
On that last point, are there any other communities that are doing that?
I believe we have identified Aurora as the only one in Illinois that we're aware of that's doing it. They had an extremely large OPEB liability, and they immediately started up this concept. We have talked to other communities that are right where we are because of the change in the GASB pronouncements, that they're looking at it right now as a strategy. So on that happy note, I'll turn it back to you, Mayor, and see if the council has any comments or questions on these two issues.
Well, I appreciate you coming up with some strategies. It would be probably helpful, not tonight, but probably helpful to see how they pan out some more detail, what some would call spreadsheet them out for us. We kind of see how they would are expected to play out in terms of the finances. But appreciate you having something under the strategies line. Greg?
Thanks, Mayor. Just for what it's worth, these two strategies, the trust fund and then the changes to contribution amounts, are exactly what I'm seeing in the private sector. I've got several clients that do it exactly that way for retiree health coverage.
And I know that there's been annual attempts, if not annual, close to it, to on PSEBA to get some better clarification around the definition of catastrophic, which drives some of these numbers. I know that legislation has been introduced not every year, every other year, and it just hasn't gone very far.
The federal or state legislation?
State legislation to actually mirror the federal definition of catastrophic injury for purposes of defining the liability.
I think it was about a year ago when we were had a similar conversation, and one of the things I had asked, maybe you can review it on the pension side. For example, when we hire a new police officer at about $55,000 somewhere, and I'm sure these numbers change, we almost have to assume that it's a $2 million liability over the life. And so, looking at what's coming, and I know you included, probably included some of that earlier, but if we could review that and say, you know, when people say we need more police officers, well, this is what it's going to cost. It's not the $55,000 a year. It's going to be a $2-2.5 million investment over time. The other thing is, I wonder when you talk about employee contributions and seeing it in the private sector as well, that's all well and good, but when you get into labor negotiations and what you're going to pay and all that, what the concern is on part of the employee is, how much do I take home to my family? How much food can I have? Can I get a car? You know, all these, the day-to-day living expenses. And so when they're negotiating, it's kind of a separate thing of how much we're gonna contribute and how much do we get to keep. And that's really part, you know, eventually you wind up catching up.
Exactly.
So that you're, you know, so that the people you're paying can actually live a life and not just plan their future death or future illnesses. And then again, we're all supposedly living longer. I guess that's the only good news we can take out of this, is that we can all expect to live longer, right?
Pay taxes longer?
Well, you know, that's the other side of it.
Commissioner, we'll put that information in the spreadsheet so Mayor Tully is at.
Thanks.
Could I just comment?
Yes, you can.
The unfortunate part about all this is that, you know, I view, from my perspective, when I look at, you know, Commissioner Barnett brought up the point of, what about bringing up some, you know, something that on an ongoing basis would save taxpayers significant amounts of money, significant, like that it would affect this, not, you know, oh, we're going to delay this project this year, but then we're going to do it next year. Well, that doesn't save any money because that's
just actually costing you more.
Perhaps it costs more, the same or more. So that's not saving money, but what is going to save money on an ongoing basis? And that's really what I'm most interested in.
One is fundamentally changing a service on an ongoing basis that's no longer being provided. Two, finding out how to provide the same service through alternative means such as outsourcing or consolidation or partnering. Those are the ways that you can do it.
And I think those are the things where, you know, unfortunately, I think we really do need to spend some focus on. I mean,
yeah, well, that's why I think we had as our high priority, or whatever we do, medium, there's no such thing as a low priority. Well, everything's a high priority action item. Major consolidation. We happen to have one that we're currently discussing, but I think that should be an ongoing priority action item, perhaps not even a priority item, but and we should always be looking for those opportunities because that's how you achieve immediate savings. By figuring out another way to do it at a lower, yes, it has to be done at a lower cost, but another way to do it, whether you maintain the service level long-term in a sustainable way without avoiding a lot of increases or eliminating or sharing that cost with somebody else.
I mean, I really believe that a lot of, you know, we're looking at this here today and everyone's like, just like, oh, this is horrible. And there's nothing, all these things, it's not, we're not going to defund stormwater, we're not going to defund police station, we're not going to defund public safety pensions, right? We're committed to do those things, but what can we do? And I think that we've really, this consolidation piece, you know, that's been bandied around a lot in political circles recently. I feel like it's thrown around very frequently, and, you know, oh, well, we're going to consolidate, you know, mosquito districts or something or other. Okay, well, we're not saving any money because, you know, we're just moving around legal structures.
Yes, but there are things that can be done. For example, if you have 32 units of government within DuPage County all doing independent mosquito abatement contracts, and you find a way through collective or group contracting to reduce the overall cost of everybody, you can actually save some money. You don't need to consolidate district political bodies to do that. But there are, it's not consolidation, it's cooperation, collaboration, consolidation, different flavors of that ice cream.
can, in some instances, achieve great benefits. One of the things we want to keep in mind is from a legislative strategy is not only encouraging people to work on this other stuff that's causing us a migraine headache, but to encourage that barriers to cooperation, consolidation, these other things are reduced. As we know from our experience with the elimination of the Fairview Avenue Fire Protection District, there were all kinds of hurdles that you had to jump through in order to make that happen. Why should it be so difficult? When you can see an obvious opportunity to save money, why should there be 17 legislative hurdles to get through?
For the taxpayers of the village of Downers Grove.
Yes.
Saves it because we were subsidizing them.
Yeah, no, it was a logical thing to do. Totally.
Right.
But in the aggregate, the taxpayers in the aggregate didn't really save a dime by doing that.
Taxpayers in Downers Grove did because they got the service paid.
But
it was prudent, but it didn't reduce the cost of government.
Well, right, because it's
not
like
fairly shifted it around.
Right, it's not like we closed a fire station or eliminated employees.
But for the people involved, it was the same.
No. But it doesn't reduce the cost of government. It does. It's a more equitable way of funding it. Absolutely.
In that case, the reduction in the cost of government actually occurred in the 60s or 70s when we started providing that service in a cooperative way.
But my point wasn't that
$1,000 a year in the organization.
My point wasn't that was a saving example. My point was trying to eliminate a unit of government, and there were all sorts of legislative hurdles to get to it. One of the things that we can ask our representatives to do is to help eliminate barriers to when these ideas come up that do save money and reduce the cost of government, that we're able to act upon them.
Those hurdles, though, I'm not quarreling, Mark, you could be more right on that, but I think the prudent thing for this body to do is in the 3 to 5 to 7 year range is assume that the same people that aren't willing to make any changes on the pension rules are the same people that are
not necessarily, because these things are atomic bombs when people talk about some of the other stuff. Sometimes you can do it. Anyway, that's a side point. This is a side point.
My main issue is
we have to look at outsourcing possibilities. We have to look at, and if there's going to be some long-term sustainable savings, you're really talking about discontinuing a service, not trying to find a few nickels here and there. Or finding a different way to provide that service than we currently are now in some kind of other fashion, which means partnering or consolidation, collaboration, whatever you want to call it. Extreme example alert. There is a county or a town in Georgia, which was formed not that long ago, certainly 1932. But I believe they have something ridiculous like 3 or 4 employees. Almost every single service is outsourced. I met the mayor of that town, and he's one of the employees. And everything's done by outsourcing. Now, there's an extreme example. I'm not suggesting that. So take that away from the headline about the deprioritizing ethics. But my point is that if we're really going to be serious about this, we have to be open and creative, and we also have to be willing to take some of the feedback we're going to get on that topic.
Those two headlines are one thing.
That percent thing is telling. It doesn't point to any solutions, to be sure. 4%, 39 is a little nutty, but if you just said 4 to 7, if you were expecting 4 to 7 for the foreseeable future, you're expecting cost of providing services that outpaces inflation and likely outpaces income growth for the residents paying those bills. And that's a danger. That's a curve that has not got a happy ending for anybody. And so, it doesn't. You're exactly right. We need to start getting specific with some ideas, and this isn't one of those. But have it in our heads, those numbers, those levy numbers, maybe we'll get some big sales tax, maybe there'll be a big income tax increase in Illinois, we'll get a bigger nut, but we need to sort of have in our head that those operational cost numbers, we need to be figuring out how to keep those things at or near inflation levels.
Right.
As a target, as a goal.
Well, yeah, obviously we need to focus on revenue opportunities too. I'm not suggesting that we raise taxes, but when there are opportunities to redirect something that we could do, I think we have to consider them.
Well, one of the things that we do well that's been recognized by rating agencies over the last year, approaching a decade or more, is that we manage these issues very well. We get out in front of them, we have public discussions. Sometimes they can be a little scary, sometimes they can be a little nerve-wracking. But we've proven that we actually take these issues and put them into action. And you can see them in our budgets, and you can see them in our accomplishments each year. So from a staff perspective, so far what we've done tonight is create the awareness that we wanted to create, not only for the council, because we briefed them individually prior to tonight, but more importantly for the community, that if these things come up and if these conversations are happening, that they understand. Maybe they've seen the video about pensions and the struggles. And so when that budget message comes out in September, if there's anything like this in here, we've already addressed it and we know what the conversation's about. So from a staff perspective, just based on what we've heard tonight from the council, this is very encouraging. What we're hearing is go ahead and start exploring, really more accurately, continue to explore the things we've always been doing. Look for these opportunities to move forward.
Yes, and obviously we all want to see more. Thank you. We want to see more about the strategies, the details. And I was going to come back and make sure that there was a word outcome over here, that you got what you expected to accomplish tonight.
Yes.
But we also, of course, need to continue to be focused on revenue generation. I know there's some people at this table that that is a very high priority, but I think it also needs people to understand the importance of economic development and of bringing, expanding the tax base so we can try to keep down some of the rates here. It's not a static environment, it's a dynamic environment, and we have to work hard at that, as well as manage the expense side. It's not just one or the other, it's both.
It would be not fun to have to add to that side on the left, TIF coverage.
Exactly.
That would be not very fun.
That would not be fun.
Yeah, that would be bad.
Mayor, we've received all the direction and discussion that we find valuable.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought this was just part one. We're going to do part two next. All right. Well, if there's nothing else that you need from us, and anyone else doesn't want to add any comments, I was going to turn it over to the audience for any comments or input. Good evening.
John, a couple of things. The $3.9 million stormwater figure, I recall that's been around for about 2 years, that number. I think that was the last council's number. I don't remember this council having a discussion on what they thought was the appropriate funding level for the entire stormwater operation capital. You may in fact think it should be 2.9 or 5.9.
Some of us think it's underfunded.
But we don't know.
We did have that discussion.
It was two stormwater utility meetings ago. I want to say the April meeting, where that was actually one of the key pieces of direction that came out of the council, was after a thorough analysis and discussion of the plan, the council directed 3.9.
We can look forward to that being the council to get a decision going forward.
Yes, sir.
Next question, I kind of follow up on Commissioner Walbeck. Has the staff done any projections on when the increase in population density is going to trigger the need to hire more first responders? And I believe it's like every 1,000 increase to hire one person, or is that one shift that you have to hire three people?
So the study that I think you're referring to, of a certain amount of public safety and first responders per X thousands of employees, that's really based on an assumption that those population expansions are happening as a growth outward. We're experiencing a growth inward, and so we're covering the same geographic territory with more density. What it does is it changes the mix of types of first responses in most cases. Yes, there's some increase, but it's really, especially on the fire and EMS side, it really ends up being a shift to more EMS. We monitor these demands for services on a regular basis. And in fact, we've been briefing the council on some trends offline that may surface in the coming years. It's really this discussion. What does our fire department look like in 5 years and 10 years and why? On the police side, we've been doing this very thorough analysis for several years. We've shifted resources within to move the police responses to the demand for service we've had. So without going back a couple of years and talking about that, the answer is yes. And we don't see right now an increase in staffing. We see a redistribution of what those first responders are doing.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Other comments, questions from our guests? Well, thank you for joining us. We will, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you and good night. Happy Flag Day. Thank you.